We have seen that with the help of the cumulants, we can formulate an objective function for the ICA problem. And we will focus on this one, which is the most frequently used one. So we take the square sum over the fourth order cross cumulants. And ideally, if all the components are independent of each other, this should be zero. And if they're not quite independent of each other, it's a positive value. So we want to minimize this. And we do this after whitening by rotating the whitened data. So X hat is the whitened data, R is the rotation matrix, and Y is our unmixed data. So we need to consider what happens if we rotate the data. One way would be, of course, to literally rotate the data and then calculate the cumulants. Now this is quite expensive. So we would rather like to rotate the cumulants. So not rotate the data and then calculate the cumulants each time, but calculate the cumulants once and then somehow rotate the cumulants. And that's considered here. So we have one particular cumulant here, and that's the definition of the cumulant for zero mean data. We know from above that the Y components result from multiplying the whitened data with the rotation matrix. Now, spelled out in components, this would be this expression here. Right? So we sum over the components of X and the rows of the matrix R, and I indicates the different rows which give rise to the components I. So this is how we would calculate yi from the whitened data and the rotation matrix. And we do this now for all four components. So, and we do the averaging here. So this expression here corresponds to this expression. And likewise, this expression corresponds to this one. And then we have two other ones that are similar to this. Oh yeah, it's shown here again. Now, summation is a linear operation, and averaging is a linear operation. So we can swap these two operations and rearrange the terms. So we take out the sums, and we have the same sums here as we have here. So we have the identical prefactor, so the sum alpha, beta, gamma, epsilon, R I alpha, R j beta, R k gamma, RL epsilon. And that's true for all the 1, 2, 3, 4 terms in this cumulant. And what remains then are the x's. We can't take them out of the averaging process because they are the varying thing that we average over. So we have x alpha, x beta, x gamma, x epsilon, or rather x hat, and the other terms. And this now actually is the cumulant in the whitened data. So we can write the cumulants after rotation as a linear combination of the cumulants before rotation, and the linear weighting factors are generated by taking the fourth order product between components of the rotation matrix. So we see that we don't need to recalculate the cumulants each time after each rotation that we test, but we need to calculate the cumulants only once, and then we can actually rotate the cumulants. So that makes life easier. Okay, so if we now look at the contrast function, we find that we can do another simplification. So normally in the contrast function we would sum over ijkl not equal iiii. So what happens if you consider the sum over all cumulant components squared? Um, So if you plug in, I mean, we have above, we have calculated the cumulant, so one cumulant from the rotation matrix and the whitened data. And if you plug in the result, we get this here. Now this is squared. Now to make this explicit, we rewrite this in two full sums here, and in order to not to get confused, we introduce new summation indices, and that's important, right? Otherwise you just mess up here. So it's kappa, lambda, mu, and nu. So we get r I kappa, r j lambda, r k mu, r l nu, c kappa, lambda, mu, nu. Again, we have two linear operations, namely this sum and this sum, or actually these two sums and this sum. We can rearrange the data or the terms. So we take these two sums to the front, which go over alpha, beta, gamma, epsilon, and kappa, lambda, mu, nu. Then we take the cumulants, which do not depend on I, j, k, l. And then we have these sums over I, j, k, l. Now, remember, R are the entries of a rotation matrix. And such a sum here would be the inner product between two columns of the matrix, right? So the first index indicates the rows, and that's the index which is summed over. The second index indicates the columns. So this one here is the inner product between column epsilon and column nu. Now, since this is a rotation matrix, it's an orthogonal matrix, and we know that an orthogonal matrix has orthogonal, or actually orthonormal, column vectors as well as row vectors. So this one, therefore, equals the Kronecker symbol. Likewise for the other three sums here. That means we can substitute the kappa by alpha, lambda by beta, mu by gamma, and nu by epsilon, because if let's say mu is not equal to epsilon, then this term is zero anyways, and that term vanishes. So only if epsilon equals mu, nu, do we get a one here, and the same is true for the other one. So only if all these four terms are equal to all these four terms, do we actually get a contribution in the sum. That means we can just drop these four indices and replace them by alpha, beta, gamma, epsilon, and that results in this term. Now, and this means that the sum over the square of all cumulants does not change under rotation, right? So these are the rotated cumulants, these are the original cumulants calculated on the whitened data, so a rotation does not change the total sum of the squared cumulants. And this has a very interesting implication. So this here is the objective function that we want to actually minimize. It's the square sum over all cross cumulants, because we know that if the cross cumulants are zero, then the coefficients are, or the components are statistically independent. So we want to minimize the square sum over the cross cumulants. However, because the total sum over all cross cumulants does not change under rotation, we can equally well simply maximize the diagonal elements, because these are the elements that are not summed over here. If you would take the sum of these two sums, you would get simply this thing, and that's a constant, right? So the sum of these two things is a constant, so therefore minimizing this part is equivalent to maximizing this part. It's quite obvious. So if you have A plus B equals constant, then max A is equivalent to min B. Not the minimum, but minimizing, maximize, maybe I should write maximize A equals minimize B. And that's what we use here. So if A plus B is constant, then maximize A is equivalent to minimizing B. Okay, so this now is really the objective function for fourth order. The same thing also holds for third order, right? So we could, rather than minimizing, we have this above. Right, so rather than minimizing this sum, we could maximize the sum over CIII squared. Okay, so now we know we have a relatively simple objective function, namely the sum over the diagonal elements of the cumulants. And maybe that's a good point to say something about the relationship between minimizing or making the components statistically independent versus making them non-Gaussian, right? So we have seen in the beginning that there are sort of two general approaches to ICA. One is to make the components statistically independent, and we have formalized that by saying we want all the cross-cumulants to be close to zero, to vanish. Yeah? And we have said another option would be to make the components themselves as non-Gaussian as possible. Now we have said that a Gaussian components typically have cumulants, so CIII or CIIII, and also higher order autocumulants that are zero. So if they're non-zero, the distribution is non-Gaussian. And that is actually sort of reflects, or is reflected here by maximizing the sum over the square of the autocumulants. So this can be interpreted intuitively as making the distributions of the individual components as non-Gaussian as possible, right? If you have a large CIIII, then we have a very quotient distribution. If you have a very negative, but by the absolute value, a small, sort of a large negative value, it's very flat and it's also non-Gaussian, right? So this reflects we want to make the components non-Gaussian, and this reflects we want to make them statistically independent. Here we see that because the sum of over these two is a constant, they're virtually the same thing, right? So they're two sides of the same coin. Okay, so now we have a relatively simple objective function, and we know that under the rotation, if we rotate the data, we can simply rotate the cumulants rather than calculating the cumulants each time again. So then the question arises, how do we do a rotation? Well, in 2D, that's very easy. The rotation matrix is cosine phi, sine phi, minus sine phi, cosine phi. Okay, that this is a rotation matrix can be seen quite easily. So let's assume coordinate system, and we consider the vector 0, 1. Yeah. Then if you multiply here 0, no, actually it's 1, 0, right? 1, 0. If you multiply this with this matrix, we just get cosine phi minus sine phi. And cosine phi minus sine phi would be cosine phi minus sine phi would be a vector like this for phi being 45 degrees, right? And if you put in 0, 1, which would be this vector, yeah, we would get sine phi cosine phi. Sine phi would become positive for 45 degrees, and cosine phi would also be positive, right? So we would have this vector for 45 degree rotation. So that's a clockwise rotation. It's actually a bit unusual. Normally, sort of the standard rotation matrix would be a counterclockwise, because counterclockwise is a positive rotation direction. Good. So this would be in 2D. And that would be it, right? Now, in higher dimensions, it is more complicated, because you have a lot of angles along which you can rotate, and the orthogonal matrix is quite a complicated thing to produce. It's not easy to parameterize. So what one then does is one defines so-called Givens rotations, which are rotation matrices like this one here, which sort of leave most of the components unchanged, depending on the size, of course, or which actually, let me phrase it a different way. So you pick two dimensions within which you do perform the rotation. In this case, it would be the second and the fourth component. So these two dimensions define the plane within which you rotate, and you leave all the other components unchanged. Now, we live in 3D, so we are used to the idea that a rotation happens around an axis. But that's sort of an accident of living in 3D, because if we do this in 3D, we have one axis that does not change, or one dimension that does not change, and two dimensions that change. If you go to 5D, there are still two dimensions that change, and in this case then three dimensions in which nothing happens, which means the axis then becomes three-dimensional, if you like. So this concept of an axis in higher dimensions does not mean that you rotate around one dimension in a six-dimensional space, which would mean that you change five dimensions, but the rotation always happens sort of in a 2D, at least a standard normal rotation. Okay. The nice thing, so this is much simpler, of course, than the general rotation matrix. And the nice thing is that any general rotation can be written as a product of Givens rotation. So if you just multiply many of these with sort of picking different dimensions, if you multiply many of these, you can generate any kind of rotation, right? So that simplifies it without losing generality.